In the 1800s, Charles Bradlaugh, a prominent atheist, made known a challenge in all England to Hugh Price Hughes, who was a Welsh minister. He challenged him to a public debate on the value of the Bible. Hughes, believing that a debate would accomplish nothing, responded saying, "I propose to you that we bring some concrete evidences on the validity of the Bible's purpose in the form of men and women saved from lives of sin and shame. I will bring 100 such men and women saved by the Bible, and I challenge you to do the same saved by atheism that denies the Bible. If you cannot bring 100 to match my 100, I will be satisfied if you will bring 50 men and women who will stand and testify that they have been lifted up from lives of sin and shame by the influences that deny the Bible's teaching. If you cannot bring 50, I challenge you to bring 20 people who will testify with shining faces, as my 100 will, that they have a great new joy and a life of self-respect as a result of your teachings. If you cannot bring 20, I will be satisfied if you bring 10. Nay, if you cannot bring 10, I challenge you to bring just one man or one woman who will make such a testimony regarding the uplifting influence of your teachings." The challenge known to all England was never accepted. Everyone in this world, my dear friends, is looking for meaning. Everyone in this world wants their life to mean something. We want to make sure that my time on this earth, that my time in Vancouver, Washington, or Portland, Oregon, or wherever you are, means something. It makes an impact on those around me. My name will be remembered. Something to tell them that their life is valuable and we are not just breathing until we stop. Everyone wants joy. Everyone wants peace. Everyone wants comfort, acceptance, fulfillment. Everyone wants a life that's worth living. Nobody comes into this world and says, "I want my life to mean nothing." The fact of the matter is, however, that there's something that this world cannot offer, and that is a life of meaning. As our Welsh minister brother stated in his challenge to the atheists some 200 years ago, a life that is free from sin and shame, a life that has been lifted up above the matters of the world, a life that produces joy that's visible to those around them, that life, my dear friends, is only available in Jesus Christ. And so I want to ask all of you, and especially those young people who profess their faith through water baptism today, to consider what it means to be found in Christ, to consider what it means to live a life of meaning, to consider what it means to live a life that is valuable, to consider, most importantly, as we look at our verse, what it means, as the Apostle Paul says, to be crucified with Christ, to have Him live in me. This is central when it comes to the Christian life, is it not? This is what Christianity ultimately boils down to. Is my life, my whole life, Christ? Are His values my values? Are His loves my loves? Is He everything to me, and am I satisfied in Him? This is what I'd like to briefly look at before we pray together and before we celebrate the sacrifice that He has made in the Lord's Supper. Friends, when your life is Christ, you obtain something that is well beyond anything you could ever hope to obtain in this world. But in order to gain that, in order to obtain that, in order to have that life that's given to those who are in Christ, something must first be lost. So let's look very briefly. In our verse, we see that in gaining that life in Christ, a life must first be lost. To understand the life that we gain, we must first understand the life that is lost. What is Paul actually saying here in the first half of verse 20? Look at it with me one more time. Verse 20 reads, "I've been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live." What's Paul saying there? What's he pointing to there when he says, "I have been crucified with Christ"? He's saying that the old man, that the old person, they're dead. That person, that man, has been crucified with Christ. He's saying that, as we read in Colossians 3, verses 9 and 10, that the old self is gone and we are to very intentionally put on the new self. The other person, with their desires, with their longings, with their earthly aspirations, that person is gone, that person is no more. Their preferences don't matter because the new person is Christ. When a person trusts in Jesus, they take up their cross and they follow after Jesus, as he himself stated one must do in Matthew 10, verse 38. And this cross, my dear friends, leads to death. Jesus' cross did not end with him bearing a burden that ultimately was just uncomfortable, that ultimately just changed the way that he viewed something or thought about something. This cross led to death. And that's what Jesus is saying. Jesus isn't just pointing to a spiritual reality or saying something that's deep and interesting to think about. And Paul, in this verse, when he says that one must be crucified, he isn't pointing to something that is just like a take it or leave it. There's one form of Christianity, there's another. No, this is very serious. This isn't just language to make a point. Friends, what the Apostle Paul says here, and listen close, this completely does away with the notion of easy believism. This completely does away with the notion that one can be a Christian and not give their whole life over. This completely does away with the notion that one can follow Christ and keep that old person along for the ride. Jesus isn't tacked on to your life and your aspirations and your goals and the things that you want to accomplish. Jesus takes over that, and that old person is done with. This is not just a matter of intellectually believing that Jesus died on the cross. It doesn't end there. And if it does, then I would venture to ask, do you understand the cross? This isn't just understanding the theological nuances of the doctrine of salvation and what it means to be forgiven of one's sins. When you put your faith in Christ, put bluntly, you die. Your heart of stone is crushed. Your pride is shattered. Your life is surrendered, and it is no more. What a marvelous reality to consider. What a reality to think about, that that person is no more. And this is not cause for concern or cause for tears for the death of that person. That person was headed straight to hell. This isn't just the end of Andre or any one of us, but rather the end of a terrible reign, the reign of death and sin. When you're crucified with Christ, you die to sin, my dear friends. You die to sin's power, you die to sin's dominion, and you die to sin's penalty, because Jesus was penalized for your sin. Jesus takes care of that once and for all. Jesus took upon himself the condemnation we deserve, and he covered it with his blood. He took your sin upon himself, and he paid for it with his very own blood. When this happens, it's not the same me anymore. It can't be that same person. I can't come out from the flood that is the blood of Jesus an unchanged man. That doesn't happen. It's not that person, again, who had thought the world revolved around them. It's not that person who focused everything on self-esteem, on self-confidence, on self-exaltation. It's not the person who lives for personal pleasure and personal position. That man is gone. The debt is paid. The old person is gone. But as we know, it's not just the death of something, but what happened after Jesus' crucifixion and what happened when we are crucified with Christ is that a new life is given. This old man is done away with, but the birth of a new person is made through the sacrifice of Jesus. And we see that in the second half of verse 20. But Christ lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. And we see that in the second half of the verse. We saw that a life is lost, that old person is done away with. The old realities, the old desires, the old preferences, that's done away with. The reign of sin, the reign of death is gone. And now this new person, this person that is created through that birth in Jesus Christ, a life is gained, a new person appears. When the old self is crucified, we don't just end up in a nebulous physical spiritual reality in some kind of state that just awaits a glory, but we are given a life. And Paul very specifically states, the life I now live in the flesh, simply meaning this physical life where we are right now. The life that you and I now live in the flesh, that's what Paul's talking about. We don't ascend to heaven at the point of salvation, but we are called to live in this present earthly reality, and not just to live, friends, to live for him. the life I now have, the life that was given to me by Christ, the life that was given as a gift, the free gift of salvation, is not just something that was given for me, but it's something that happens as the result of something else. It's not just tossed my way, take it or leave it. It's something that was done for me, and it results in something. In the original language that this book would have been written in, the Greek, the verb live is what's known as the perfect tense, which points to a past completed action. Paul very intentionally uses this word. He's pointing to the past action that would have happened, and he's pointing to that, and he says this past action in the perfect tense, it must have continuing results. Christianity does not stop when we dodge the bullet of hell and we say, whew, at least not headed there. Christianity creates a life. Christianity must create a life, or else we must ask the question, is this what they're talking about here? Is this what Jesus calls his people to? In a time when everyone is encouraged, in our time, when everyone is encouraged to live life to the fullest, to pursue all this world has to offer, you take that vacation, you buy yourself that nice car, you deserve it, you treat yourself, you get that whatever you want, you live how you want. In the world that tells you that, at this very time, we must understand what God says here, that Christianity, in the truest sense, in the realest sense, is life by faith in the Son of God. And that has to create something beyond, what am I eating today? What do I want to work towards? What's the next thing I'm buying? This is not a life with just as many experiences as can be had. This is not just a life that tries to obtain a certain comfort level. This is not just a life of recognition and acclaim and the approval of others. Life for Christ is life by faith and life given over to Christ. Many people don't seem to understand that not only is this the only life which can offer true satisfaction and fulfillment, but this is the only life worth living. Everything else is a cheap substitute. And Christian, I know you're saying in your heart, amen and amen, but how many of us pursue that cheap frivolity which offers no satisfaction? It's Jesus or it's nothing. The person that understands this, that experiences this, they long to live a life that places the needs of others before themselves. They long to be in fellowship, in ministry. The church is home. This is my family. These are my people. Of course I want to serve them. Of course I want to be here. That's made new. That's not the natural state. And so when we're made new, when we're crucified with Christ, when we're given that life, that's the natural new disposition. This person seeks to tell others of Christ, this Christ that has given them a life. You don't take that news and put it under the basket. You don't take that news and hide it away. You shine that light because He is your life. That's what it means. A life for Christ is a happy life. A life for Christ is found in flourishing. A life for Christ is seen in the way that we grow and we expand and we press on the cause of the gospel to those who need to hear it. And why do we live this way? Why does this happen? What do we see in the text? Why is this the life? Why is it? Are we just following another command? Are we just obeying another thing that we see in Scripture? Because He loved me and gave Himself for me. Friend, that should bowl you over every time you read it. Every time we encounter this reality in the Word of God, that should stop us dead in our tracks. He saw the filth that was filling up my heart, the thoughts that filled up my mind, the things done by these hands, and He loved me and gave Himself for me. Paul says this not to make us feel good and not to boost our self-esteem. He says this to show us why we live this life for Him. Why it matters that as believers our life is Christ. It's this reminder, He loved you. He gave Himself for you. Brothers and sisters, this is the key to Christian life. Faith in Christ, not just the Christ who died on the cross for you, but the Christ who lives in you today. It's easy to reflect and say, oh yes, what a beautiful thing my Savior did for me. But He lives in you presently, and that creates a life. We live by faith in Him every moment of every day, believing Him to be our strength. We believe in Him to be our sustenance, our joy, our peace, our satisfaction, more than money, more than things, more than relationships, more than acclaim, more than anything else. We believe Christ to be our purity and our holiness and our power over sin. This is Christianity. Living by faith in the Son of God and being completely satisfied by Him. Ignatius, he was a student of the Apostle John and former bishop of Antioch in the first and second centuries, said this as he faced suffering and death, as he was about to die for the name of Jesus. Let fire and the cross, let the companions of wild beasts, let breakings of bones and tearing of members, let the shattering in pieces of the whole body and all the wicked torments of the devil come upon me. Only let me enjoy Jesus Christ. Ignatius understood that a life lived for anything other than Jesus was a life wasted. A life lived enjoying anything other than Him was a life tossed away. Don't waste your life, dear friends. You young people especially, don't waste your life. You have this opportunity to give Jesus everything, give His people everything, to understand what He has done for you, what you testified of today. Don't waste your life. Don't go chasing the pleasures of this life, thinking that they'll somehow satisfy, that they'll somehow offer something. They never will. They'll always disappoint, and they'll always leave you feeling emptier than you started. I pray that the words of the Apostle Paul are true for each of you, my dear friends, my young friends, and each of us, when he says, I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave Himself for me.